morning. I am Somayajulu, Professor of Computer Science and Engineering, National Institute of Technology. This is the second lecture in the module Online Analytical Processing. The title of this lecture is Multidimensional Data Model. Underlying concept used in Olap processing is the Multidimensional Data Model. This model basically uses a structure called data cube in representing the data. In this lecture, we study what is multidimensional model, what are the different kinds of operators that are supported in Olap, and finally, we conclude this lecture by highlighting how to build a data cube using SQL features. Multidimensional analysis is a very popular approach to extend additional features for reporting. Instead of submitting multiple queries, data is structured to trigger fast and easy access to interactively answer the questions posed by the different kinds of users. This kind of analysis is generally performed on large corporate data warehouses or data marts. The view of data as multidimensional array can be generalized to more than three dimensions. In OLAP applications, the bulk of the data can be represented in such a multidimensional array. The systems which use arrays to store multidimensional data sets is termed as MOLAP systems. Multidimensional array can also be represented as a table as shown in the slide. The relation with related dimensions to the measure of interest is called fact table. Multidimensional data model focus mainly on a collection of measures called numerical measures, which are termed as facts and depends on a number of associated dimensions. In the data warehousing literature, data cube is one of the popular structure which is very widely used in representing the multidimensional model. We represented the multidimensional data model in two ways. One is in the form of a table and another is in the form of an array. The dimension names are not shown in the slide, but the IDs associated with each dimension are represented as PID for product ID, time ID for time dimension, location ID for location dimension, and sales is here is a numerical measure. This representation shows the annual sales of various categories of products in different quarters or different cities. For example, annual sales of TV for three cities are shown in the form of an array and the total sales are shown in the form of a simple number. So if you observe this diagram, we have different kinds of aggregations stored in this physical structure. One is the total sales over all cities for all products, and another kind of aggregation is the total sales over all quarters for each product, and another kind of aggregation is the total sales over all products for each quarter, etc. So if you observe this diagram specifies the different kinds of aggregations in the form of a physical structure called data cube. So here we have only three dimensions, but if we have more than three dimensions, you can't find a physical structure, but we can always generalize this representation by using the concept called hypercube. Slide shows the different kinds of computations with respect to the three dimensions, namely product, date, country. That means to say we have combined the computations across the combinations of these dimensions. If you see this diagram is an integration of the different kinds of computations over the combinations of these three dimensions. So this each combination is nothing but a particular category of cuboid. So here there are four different types of cuboids. Zero dimensional cuboid, which is nothing but apex cuboid, which gives the grand sales, and base dimension cuboid, which gives the sales of each product on each date for each country. And between these two aggregations, we have different kinds of computations. But the beauty of this structure is whatever the computation we do at intermediate level, the value is always more than the computation from the lower level and smaller than the computation of the higher level. So this type of structure in mathematics we term as lattice. So the concept of data cube imitates the behavior of the lattice because we are taking all the combinations with some ordering. So that ordering is nothing but a partial ordering. This slide talks about the extension of the three-dimensional cuboid into a collection of four-dimensional cuboids. So if we have four dimensions, we have 2 to the power of 4 combinations. That is 16 such cuboids. Out of 16 dimensions, we have one cuboid of 0 dimension, we have one cuboid of 4 dimensions, and 4 cuboids of 3 dimension nature, and 6 cuboids of 2 dimension nature, etc. Of all these cuboids, we'll have 16 such cuboids. So in a similar way, you can extend these combinations of computations over several dimensions in the form of a structure. But however, there is no physical structure exists to show visually when the number of dimensions are more than 3. But if it is less than 3, you can always show physically 3. But if it is more than 3, we have to think in an abstract sense in the form of a cube called hypercube. Now, the floor is open for questions. Any questions, please?
What is hypercube? How is it to be used is my question.
As I mentioned in this lecture, hypercube is a generic metaphor for representing the multidimensional data. A group of data cells arranged by the dimensions of the data. Say, for example, if you take spreadsheet exemplifies a two-dimensional array with data cells arranged in rows and columns, each being a dimension. That means row is one dimension, column is another dimension. In a similar way, if you think even database table is also represented in the form of rows and columns. So both the representation, spreadsheets as well as database tables, are metaphors for representing the data in Excel sheets as well as the data in databases. In a similar way, hypercube is a generic metaphor for representing multidimensional data. I'll demonstrate now. Since this is a complex topic, I'll go in more detailed manner about the concept of hypercube. As I mentioned, spreadsheets use worksheets, databases use tables. Hypercubes are used to understand multidimensional views. For example, consider two-dimensional cross-tabulation report which models a location and product to measure sales share. So this two-dimensional grid provides all possible combinations of locations and products. So that means if you have K locations and P products, for each combination of location across the products, sales are computed here. Now coming to your second question, how it is viewed. In fact, you can view the hypercube in an abstract manner by understanding how the cube is built in one dimension, how the cube is viewed in two dimensions, and how the cube is viewed in three dimensions, etc. So now I explain step by step how it is viewed in each category of dimensions. Suppose if you have a one dimension, you can view the data in a single row or a column. If you have two dimensions, like in our case, location and products, it is a matrix or a table. If the number of dimensions are more than three, imagination of hypercube is quite difficult. In the sense that you cannot represent physically in the form of a structure, but you should understand in an abstract sense. So in the sense that, suppose if you imagine a control panel on a stereo sound system. We all use a stereo sound system for day-to-day presentations. So if you use the sound system, each slider control one aspect of the sound, such as balance, volume, bass, and treble. So all these things are knobs which can be controlled. You can adjust the parameter values. In a similar way, if you have more than three dimensions, you can map these higher dimensional data into a two-dimensional grid in this manner. So what is going to happen if you add more and more dimensions, such as payment method, coupons, etc., the grid become cube. That means if I add a location product dimension, payment method is added, it is a three-dimensional cube. Coupons is added, it is then become a hypercube, which we call as a four dimensions in this case, and so forth. Any number of dimensions can be added. So therefore, there is no physical metaphor exists for more than three dimensions. That is the reason why we should think in the form of abstract sense. Is it clear? So this is how we should interpret the concept of hypercube by generalizing from one dimension to two dimensions, three dimensions, and beyond three dimensions.
So my question is, can you explain cube with an example by taking measures and dimensions?
In my presentation, I already explained the concept of data cube by taking the dimensions and measures. So in our discussion, we stated products, location, time as dimensions. Total sales is considered as a measure. I will elaborate once again by taking a different kind of scenario to explain this concept once again. If you see in a normal commercial tools like cognos or business objects, etc., there is a concept of cube. That means Olap software packages support this transformation with the name called power cube. So this power cube concept is available as a part of Cognos tool. Cognos provided with a module called transformer. This transformer's job is to transform the data into the form of a cube, which is nothing but hypercube. But from the terminology point of view, Cognos tool names this as a power cube. So in a sense, power cube is same as a hypercube. So this is basically used to organize the data into selected business perspectives. So for example, the picture shown on the slide gives a power cube involving some measures and dimensions. For example, here time is a dimension, job group is a dimension, status is a dimension, performance and indicators and salaries are measures. So that means here, when you take a particular category of value on each dimension, you get a combination. On that combination, you are computing the aggregated values for all these measures. The cell contains these aggregated values. As I mentioned earlier, if you see the hypercube concept, there is no physical metaphor exists for hypercube, but I can always map into a two-dimensional plane. So for example here, there are four dimensions exist here. And I can add as many dimensions as I want. Then by the moment I define the measures here, across these combinations of the dimensions, measures are automatically computed based on the functions you define. Once the functions are triggered, a cube is generated and then shown here. So in a way, a hypercube can always be simulated using the facility that is provided in Cognos with a name called transformer. To extend your the discussion for your question, since this is an abstract concept, I would also like to extend the discussion by representing physically the data in both the forms. For example, if you take a two-dimensional representation, cube represents data as cells in an array. And relational table, as you know, relational table only represents multidimensional data in two dimensions. Suppose if you take an example of two-dimensional array, what is the total revenue generated by property sales in each city in each quarter of 2009? That means if you define that there are four quarters in a year, for each quarter in each city, what are the total sales? So this is a two-dimensional grid. So the measure is here sales. But choice of representation always based on types of queries end user asks. So there are two different kinds of representations. Array-based representation and tabular representation. Now if you observe the table representation, in order to represent all the sales in each city for each quarter in the year 2009, we need three columns. First column is for city values, second column is for quarter names, and third column is for storing the measure. So that means to store the data in a three-field relational table requires three columns. But suppose if I represent the same data in a matrix, we require only two columns. For example, here
These are the city values, these are the times, and this is the total revenue. In this representation, there are two dimensions and one measure. The same data is transformed in the form of a matrix representation by considering the database values stored across these rows. Here, that means here the dimension values are nothing but database values here, class, row, quarter, quarter names, etc. These will become the headings for row and columns. For example, Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4 are the headings for the quarter. Glasgow, London, etc. are the headings for city. Then, if you take the combination of these for the time dimension, we get a revenue. So, the cell value says the total revenue in the city London for quarter Q1. Similarly, the cell value 45677 is the total revenue in this city for quarter number 3. So here the city is Aberdeen. So this way the representation differs. Dimensional, two-dimensional representation, if you represent in the form of an array, it requires only how many cells it requires? Depending on the number of values. Suppose here there are 4 values, and if you take only 3 cities, then we have 12 cells. 4 into 3, 12 cells. But whereas here, each row consists of 3 columns, so we need to add more number of cells. So as I mentioned, both the things uses the concept of cell, but the way the data is represented in the two-dimensional matrix tells you the database values becomes the column headings here. If you extend it, the same representation by adding a property, say sales, generated by, what is the total revenue generated by property sales for each type of property, say either flat or house, in each city, in each quarter of 2009. So now how many columns are required in the tabular representation? Can anybody answer? How many columns are required here to store the results for this query in a tabular representation? 4 columns. When one dimension is added, 3 plus 1, 4 columns. Out of 4, 3 columns are for representing the dimensions, 1 column for representing the measure. The same representation, suppose if we extend into a matrix form, a two-dimensional matrix now will become a three-dimensional. One more dimension is added here, property type, to our earlier discussion. House and flat are the two rows. So, for each type of flat, what are the sales in each city for each quarter? The total revenue is calculated and shown here. So, if you see the diagram, when one more dimension is added, the physical representation of a two-dimensional representation now became a three-dimensional representation, which we call as a cube. So this is a cubic structure, physical structure. Is it clear? So this is how the measures are computed. Remember, all these measures are aggregated in nature. Depending on the combinations of the attributes, the respective aggregation operation is applied for each combination, and the cell value for that combination contains this measure. So that is why measures are associated with the dimensions. Is it clear? Okay. Any questions?
Sir, I would like to know what are the different kinds of functional support provided for data queues in commercial databases?
I repeat the question posed by one of the students. What are the different kinds of functional support provided for data cubes in commercial databases? So you all know that there are very popular commercial databases exist today in the market. They are DB2, SQL Server, Oracle, Ingress, Postgres, etc. In fact, all these packages are now providing latest versions, the functional support for data cube. That means the functionality of the traditional SQL features are extended by incorporating the additional features to do the manipulations for multidimensional operations. As I mentioned, there are different kinds of multidimensional operations: slicing, dicing, pivoting, rotation, roll up, drill down. So to perform these operations, we need a lot of aggregations. A lot of computation is required at the back end of your database. So therefore, most of the commercial databases push the functionality within the language level by incorporating various powerful operators. For example, if you take Oracle provides two different kinds of powerful operators, namely roll-up, to do the aggregation on selected combinations of dimensions, and cube to compute the different kinds of possible combinations across k dimensions. Similarly, grouping set helps you to compute the selected combinations of aggregations. So in a way, whatever the facilities are required to manipulate the cube quickly, to perform such queries at the backend database level, the operators are already available in packages. So I request all the students to practice these type of operations in the respective laboratories by working out on sample problems using these facilities. I'm happy that the students are asking good questions. So in fact, interaction is very much essential between the teacher and student. So I know that many are raising your hands to ask more tougher questions also. So I'm happy to receive the questions, and also I'll try my level best to answer the questions.
Explain lattice concept with an example.
This concept also I explained in this class. You all know that there are different kinds of subsets of a given set. Suppose if you have k elements in a set, you can have 2 power k subsets, including empty set. What is the relationship exists among these subsets? If you take any k element subset, this k element subset always contains k minus 1 element subsets also. In the sense that if you have a 2 element subset, say, then this 2 element subset always contained in a 3 element subset. That means what is the meaning of containment? Containment is nothing but some kind of subset ordering, right? I can always order all these 2 to the power of k subsets in a partial order with the relationship called containment. Okay, then when you prepare this order, you take any element. The element is always more than the one element subset, more than one subset. So what is that subset? Empty set. You take any subset, it is always more than the empty set. In a similar way, if you take any subset, that is always contained in the original set. So if you observe this, we have some relationship, partial ordering, and also greatest lower bound and least upper bound. Why greatest lower bound? And if you take any subset, that is always less than the original set. So that least upper bound and greatest lower bound along with the partial order exists in this subset. This is nothing but a lattice. In a sense, a lattice is a partial order set with bounds. The same concept is widely used here in the multidimensional analysis for representing the data cube. Now what I do is, I will demonstrate this lattice structure with presentation, how it is constructed. Suppose if you have 3 dimensions, namely products, city, date. We consider these as our 3 elements, which are nothing but perspectives or dimensions in our multidimensional terminology. If you take these 3 elements, we have three combinations of two element sets: product city, product date, city date, and also one combination which contains all three perspectives, namely product, city, and date. So as I mentioned, since there are three dimensions involved here, we have 2 to the power of 3, that means 8 combinations. All those 8 combinations are displayed here. I will show why it is called lattice by taking the property associated with the data cube. As I mentioned earlier, data cube contains only the aggregated values over the dimensions. Suppose if we see, if I take the product city date combinations of values and the sales, say, then by using these combinations of values, I can find the total sales for each product over each city. And these product city values are always contained in this, because product city is a subset of this. This is the containment. Even though the containment principle is there, but the aggregated values are computed by taking the measures associated with this combination. So this is one kind of cuboid. This is called one cuboid. What is this cuboid? It is a two-dimensional cuboid. Whereas this one is a three-dimensional cuboid. Whereas this one is an apex cuboid, zero-dimensional cuboid. We call this as the base cuboid. All these aggregations are computed from this. Similar way, if you think, we can do the two-dimensional computations by taking the product city combination, product date combination, and city date combination. Once you have two-dimensional aggregations, we can as well compute the total sales for each product. Means that I am taking the over all cities and over all dates. So here, product dimension, there can be k products, then we'll have k rows for each category of product, P1, P2, etc., PK. For each PI, what are the total sales? Total sales means what? The total sales over all cities where that product has appeared on all dates. So that is computed again by using these combinations, two-dimensional combinations. Similarly, the city date combination, then city date computation. These are called one-dimensional cuboids. Then, by using one-dimensional cuboids, I can compute the grand sales. That means over all products, over all cities, on all dates. That is called grand sales. So if you observe, this is the grand sale, the highest number. These are the set of numbers for each combination of product city date. So this is our greatest lower bound. Any combination you take for any combination, that value, or in other words, that measure is always more than this. Similarly, all these three are always more than these two. Similarly, this is always more than all the three. So this is the least upper bound, in the sense that whatever the sales aggregations you are computing across the combinations of various dimensions, those values are always less than this and always more than this. So that is, it imitates the behavior of lattice with the GLB and the LUB concept. That is the reason why a cube is nothing but a data cube, which is a collection of all the cuboids. Each cuboid is a one type of aggregation. Two-dimensional aggregations, three-dimensional aggregation, one-dimensional aggregations, and all-dimensional aggregations. So if you integrate all these values, it is nothing but a data cube. Is it clear? Any questions on this?
Sir, why should we take a cuboid in a multi-dimensional model? Why not any other, again, if there are more than 4 dimensions?
For understanding purpose, I will repeat the question once again here. Why should we take cuboid in multi-dimensional model? Why not any of the polygon when there are more than 4 dimensions? I am repeating once again. As I mentioned earlier, There is no physical metaphor exists for more than three dimensions. Physically, you cannot view. We have to think in an abstract sense, and the representation is a messy representation when you have more than three. In a jovial way, to answer this question, this is like the way a table is used for relational. Why a table is used for relational? Why worksheet is used for, why Excel sheet is a two-dimensional? Or in other words, worksheet for spreadsheet? In a similar way here also, cuboid is a mathematical terminology which was brought from the discrete mathematics for representing certain types of aggregations. So the representation of the aggregations always follows the containment principle. So like relational model is having a strong mathematical background, like a base, which is nothing but a set concept. In a similar way, here also, the hypercube, or in other words, a cuboid concept is widely used in multidimensional model. Why not of polygon means, polygon is a generalized term. Poly means many, many lines. So, in a way, cuboid is a part of polygon. Right? So, when a number of dimensions are more than three, there is no physical structure to view the results visually. I'm repeating once again, visual representation is not possible. But abstract representation is always possible because it has a strong mathematical base. There is no visual metaphor to represent the whole data or four-dimensional data set. Then, in that situation, how should we organize such data on a screen? We can organize when it is four, but with a lot of pointers, messiness will be there on your representation. So that is the reason why we map the n-dimensional representation into a two-dimensional square, nothing but our screen, right? So in fact, the technical name given for four dimensions in mathematics is termed as tesseract. So hypercube, when it is a three-dimension, it is a cube. When it is a four-dimension, it is called tesseract. So there is no visual metaphor for tesseract. That is why we are thinking in abstract sense by using the concept of cuboid. Clear? Next question.
The basic difference between relational database management systems and multidimensional database management systems.
In order to understand the other features on the concept of data cube, which is a lattice structure, if you observe here, all is a zero-dimensional cuboid. Product, city, date are one-dimensional cuboids. Product, city, product, date, city, date are two-dimensional cuboids. What is going to happen when we add one more dimension? As I mentioned just now, the visual representation for four dimensions is messy. Right? How do we say that is messy? If you see the diagram, then you can understand how messy it is. See this. But even though the diagram is messy, in an abstract sense, we can understand this diagram by interpreting in the form of a lattice. So if you observe here, it is a total aggregation, that is zero dimension cuboid, then four dimension cuboid, then this is three dimensional cuboids, two dimensional cuboids, one-dimensional cuboids. Now let us come back to your question. So your question is, what is the difference between the relational database and multidimensional database systems? In the name itself, it is there, relational database, multidimensional database. Multidimensionality is the difference, number one, right? But from the functionality point of view, both are used for certain kind of activities. For example, again I will narrate the differences with a diagrammatic representation. So here I have taken an example with two dimensions, namely model and color and sales volume. The same is converted here into a multidimensional database. In the multidimensional database, the data is transformed into square here because there are only two dimensions. So whatever the values are given here, blue, red, white, they became the column names or column headings. Similarly, minivan, sports, coupe, sedan are the row headings. Suppose if you have three values here and three values here, then the three column representation of a relational model requires 9 into 3, 27 cells. But whereas multidimensional database representation model requires only 9 cells, 3 into 3, 9 cells. Because there are three values here, three values. If you extend the complexity by adding one more column, say dealership, dealer is added here. So whenever one more dimension is added, I am putting a three column for perspectives, that means dimensions, and one column per sales volume. So it's a four column table. In this situation, we'll have a set of two dimensional matrices. Each square is meant for one dealer. Since there are three dealers, we have three different squares. This is one square for this dealer, this is the middle square is the middle dealer, last square is for the last dealer. So that means if I select a particular dealer, then I can get a matrix slice. So if you observe the complexity here, when one dimension is added in a multidimensional representation, it requires always less number of cells compared to the relational table representation. So I am generalizing this with the computation again. In the relational DBMS for three dimensions with one measure requires 108 cells, 27 into 4. Whereas here it requires only 27 cells. So this is much faster. Operations on this is always faster than operations on the relational table. Suppose if I add one more dimension, say time. Time is added, then how do we represent? You can view in an abstract sense what are the sales over different kinds of models of different kinds of colors in the month of January, then in the month of February, March, April, etc. So if you see, for each month there is a three-dimensional structure. One more dimension is added here. So if you want to represent physically all these combinations of four, it is not possible. So this is called multidimensional representation. In databases, we always represent tables for storing the data. But in multidimensional representation, we use the concept of arrays, highly discrepant arrays, to represent the data. So in a way, multidimensional systems are much faster than the relational database systems because of less storage space, and also it accommodates more number of values in less storage. That is the reason why, compared to relational, multidimensional representation is better one. Clear?
Need for multidimensional analysis. Generally, one-dimensional queries, say for example, how many units of item A did we sell in the store located in Delhi? This type of query will never give any satisfaction for decision makers compared to the other query shown on the slide. The other query shown on the slide is, how much revenue did the new item generate during the last 6 months, broken down by individual months in the state of Andhra Pradesh, by individual stores, broken down by promotions, compared to estimates, and compared to the previous version of the product. So if you see this query compared to the first query, it is a quite complex query. Decision maker even further extend this query for further comparisons to similar products, comparisons among different regions, and views the result by rotating the presentation between the columns and rows. So if you observe, there is a lot of complex computation involved in query 2 compared to query key 1. For effective analysis, decision makers should equip with easy way of calculating complex analysis along several business dimensions. Such an environment we can establish using the the representation of the data model called multidimensional model. The basic advantage of using this model is to provide easy and flexible access to information. Decision makers have an ability to analyze the data along any number of dimensions at any level of aggregation with the capability of viewing the results in a varied number of ways. Also, they must have ability to navigate the results from one level of summarization to next level of summarization and vice versa. Such a type of power is not exist in the one-dimensional queries. Therefore, without having a solid system with this kind of facility, the purpose of using the data warehouse is incomplete. That is the reason why multidimensional analysis is very widely used. Of course, time is also very important dimension in any system. Every analytical query is executed with the time as one of the dimension, and it is unique in nature because of its sequential nature. An analytical system must recognize the sequential nature of time. Because of these factors, traditional systems are very much inappropriate for answering complex questions, which are generally very demand-oriented form of decision-making point of view. Therefore, multidimensional analysis is very much essential in data warehouse system. Shows the hierarchical nature of representing the dimensions, which are termed in Olap terminology as concept hierarchy. Concept hierarchy is a very important principle and widely used in data warehouses. Concept hierarchy defines a sequence of mappings from a set of low-level concepts to higher-level concepts, which are more general in nature. Different concept hierarchies for region, product, and time are shown on the slide. Here, for example, the time is having two different kinds of hierarchies. Day, collection of days is a month, collection of months is a quarter, collection of quarters is a year. It is a hierarchy. Day-wise data can also be represented as collection of days as a week and collection of weeks as a year. Similarly, office, city, country, region is another hierarchy for the region dimension, which is nothing but location dimension here. Product, category, industry is another kind of hierarchy for product dimension. So the purpose of using the hierarchy in OLAP is basically used to provide a better navigation facility for the decision maker. He can navigate with respect to the hierarchical points which are considered as footprints here.
My question is, why multidimensional analysis is very important, and explain.
The importance of multidimensional representation from the analysis point of view, this we call as very important structure, because it is very easy and flexible access, in the sense that you can retrieve any kind of aggregations just by querying. So it is easy and flexible access. Any kind of ad hoc queries can be answered once this representation is used. Then also another advantage is analysis of the data is easy. And we can also show the results by varying the levels. That means I can do computation from bottom to top or top to bottom, which we call in OLAP as roll down or drill down. So because of these three, multidimensional analysis is very important for business people.
Sir, I want to know what are the constraints that can be applied on the OLAP queue.
First of all, I would like to know, is your question is related to implementation aspect or theoretical aspect? Question. Depending on that, I can answer any question. What is there in your mind? So in the sense that you are saying that what are the constraints that we can apply on the OLAP queue? So constraints from the implementation point of view or from the theoretical point of view, we are asking this question.
From implementation point of view.
So my job is easy, right? From the implementation point of view, as I mentioned earlier, there are various extensions available in SQL with the operator names as rollup and queue. But the disadvantage of these operators is that there is no way to compute the desired set of aggregation using them. In the sense that if you use rollup with k dimensions, you can do k plus 1 aggregations. If you use queue with k dimensions, you can compute 2 power k combinations of aggregations. So from the constraints point of view here, suppose if the analyst wants to view only desired set of combinations of aggregations, there are no automated way in rollup and cube operators. So to support that, every package enriches the functionality of the SQL by supporting another concept called grouping function. So this grouping function helps you to compute the desired levels of combinations of aggregations. That means it is providing a flexibility for the analyst to represent his combinations using this concept. So in a way, it is a constraint to do the restrictions of aggregations. Have I answered your question correctly? In addition to that, most of the relational packages also provides partial roll-up, partial cube computations by extending the grouping function operator. So all these things are basically used to restrict the computation of aggregations. If there is no restriction facility available, even though the analyst is not interested, this roll-up and cube computes all combinations, which is waste of computation, and waste of storage space, waste of time. So that's why that flexibility is provided at the language level to do the computations at the desired levels of combinations of aggregations. The same question can also be answered theoretically. It is out of the scope of this lecture. There are different kinds of data cube computations exist in the literature, namely iceberg queries, which are very widely used in a priori algorithm concept also, and PEC algorithm. They are all intelligent ways to compute theoretically the aggregation. So I'll answer your question in the next lecture by taking the theoretical flavor into account.
Very important. The question is navigation. What is navigation and what are the different Olap operators that facilitate navigation?
I use this terminology called navigation. The navigation is basically used to move from one level of concept to other level of concept. That means from low level concepts to higher level concepts. If you see the lattice structure, the low level concept is a n-dimensional cuboid. Zero-dimensional cuboid is the higher level structure. So from once you know the low level data, that means once you have a low level aggregations of data, then I can compute all these higher level computations by moving from one level to another level. That means I am making the generalization of these aggregations. So in Olap, this is possible by using the two powerful operators, namely roll up and drill down. So now what I'll do is, why it is called navigation in my presentation, I will demonstrate with the full example. So if you observe this structure, if you observe the structure, from this we are computing the aggregations at this level, and then from this we are going to compute the aggregations at the next level, sales for each product, then from this we are computing the aggregations over all products. So moving from this concept to this concept, this concept to this concept, this concept to this concept is called a navigation. This navigation in Olap is termed as roll up. You are moving from, a path shows roll up. You are moving from low level concept to highest level concept. Highest level concept is grand sales or total average. That is the highest combination. In a similar way, there is another operator called drill down, which is a reverse of roll up. You are moving from top level to the next lower level, then from this level to the next lower level, namely productivity combinations of aggregations, and then from this to the lowest level, namely productivity rate combination. And you cannot go down because this is the lowest set of values that you are having in your structure. Suppose if you have further details, then you can go down. So this is the drill down. You are moving from higher level to lower level, higher conceptual level to lower conceptual level. So this is called a another kind of navigation. So navigation is basically used for moving from higher level to lower level or vice versa. Clear?
Olap operator. Now we discuss how to manipulate data cube using the Olap operation. As you know, there are different kinds of Olap operators in Olap tool. The summary of all these Olap operators are shown on the slide. They are slicing, dicing, drill down, roll up or drill up, then pivot. These five operators will provide a easy access and flexibility for the decision maker to navigate the different kinds of aggregation by fixing hierarchy on each dimension. So these operators are very convenient set of operators for the end user. The issue here is, can we simulate the concept of data cube using SQL? If this type of question is posed by the developers, we all should share that as yes to this question. Yes, we can easily simulate the data cube. That means we cannot show the physical representation of the data cube when the number of dimensions exceeds more than 3. But irrespective of the number of dimensions, we can always compute the different kinds of aggregations that are essential in building the data cube using SQL. In this, I present only a general approach followed in SQL. In the subsequent lecture, we discuss in a more detailed way how to simulate data cube using SQL. You all know that the popular class used in SQL to do the aggregation is group by class. So by writing different kinds of queries using group by class, we can combine the different kinds of aggregations by applying union operator on various subqueries. For example, if we have two dimensions, as I mentioned, we have 2 to the power of 2 combinations of aggregations. That is 4 different kinds of SQL queries you should write. One query is for grand sum, and another query is for base cuboid, and remaining 2 queries are aggregations on each dimension. So when you have 4 queries, one for each cuboid, then by union operator of SQL, I can combine all the results of these 4 queries into a single answer set. So that means to say, whatever the results the data cube gives over any number of dimensions, those results can be simulated in the form of a single query using SQL. The proof is, only we need to represent the different kinds of subqueries, and then all these subqueries must be united using the union operator. So if you do this way, we can easily get possible set of aggregated values that are required to represent the data cube. So in the next class, I will demonstrate how to build the data cube by taking a simple example with 2 dimensions as well as with 3 dimensions, and then using Oracle SQL, I will demonstrate how to simulate the data cube. Thank you.